little bit of a premise. The story that I have published in this wonderful collection with my esteemed fellow writers that I'm really privileged to be included with. The story is based on the time that I spent. I lived about 10 years in Los Angeles and really just was fascinated, was inspired by the different workers I saw there, particularly with this story, the domestic workers who I would see filing off the MTA buses in Beverly Hills and Bel Air. I mean, there really are literally armies of domestic workers who just get dropped off in the morning, do their work, nannying, cleaning houses, and then get bused who knows where to. So I wanted to know where do they go, where do they come from, what are their stories. So I'll read a bit from here in the States, which is inspired by seeing that scene, that daily ritual. Here in the States, it says, it's Friday morning, and we're running late because Frankie peed in his pants, and Nanai has to help him wash. I hide in the hallway, trying not to let Nanai see me. She peels my brother's pants off one leg at a time. I can smell the pee from where I'm standing. It's a sour smell that reminds me of the hospital Tatai works at. We hardly see him anymore because he's always at work. I go to the kitchen instead, which is as far away in the apartment as I can get from that smell. Nita, Frankie's twin, is at the table drowning a waffle in a pool of syrup. Morning, she says before taking a bite. All I can think about is how I'm supposed to be at school 20 minutes earlier than usual because we have a field trip. When Miss Gennaro announced we raised enough money to go somewhere before our last year of middle school, we thought it'd be Disneyland or Universal Studios. But when she told us we were visiting the LA Museum of Art, everyone groaned. We said we'd rather stay in Long Beach. Even though I'm not interested in seeing a bunch of stuffy paintings, today's the big day and I don't want to be late. Alma, I hear Nanai call, but there's no way I'm answering. Nanai should have remembered my trip. She should know I have to leave soon. Ever since we moved to the States, I've had to look after my brother and sister, clean their messes, cook their food, do everything. Back in the Philippines, our house was tidier, the meals weren't burned at the edges or left frozen in the middle. Our housekeeper, Amalia, would cook breakfast, merienda, and dinner. Now we're even lucky if Nanai comes home in time to make something. Usually I end up having to, and I hate cooking. I turn to the clock and watch the second hand race. Nanai says the twins are too young to walk to school alone, so I have to sit and wait while Nita spoons butter into her mouth and Nanai helps Frankie find a clean pair of pants. This wasn't at all what I thought it would be like when we came here. Underneath the clock is an old picture of Nanai. She taught history at the University of San Carlos in Cebu. I remember she'd come home with arms full of books and stay up late reading students' papers, marking them with a red pen. In this picture, Nanai stands proudly next to some men she worked with. Everyone's dressed in fancy suits. All these professors used to come over on weekends and holidays for formal dinner parties that Nanai liked to host. Nanai's face was young and fresh then. She didn't have any of the worry wrinkles she has now. I have to look away because Nanai's face then doesn't match what I see today. Finally, Nita drops her spoon. I'm done, she announces. Let's go, I say, getting up. Nanai and Frankie are at the back door now. Nanai's helping him with his backpack. I've been calling you, Alma. What were you doing, she asks. Her hair hangs loose past her shoulders. She still has to put it in a bun the way she always does. Nanai looks tired when she doesn't have any makeup on. She wears tennis shoes to work now instead of those shiny pumps she used to always buy. She yawns loud, her mouth gaping. I know I shouldn't be, but I'm glad she feels bad. She deserves it. I was with Nita, I say, looking her straight in the eyes. I needed you, she flashes anger at me, and I feel like kicking something, but I can't. Instead, I say, I'm not supposed to take care of Nita and Frankie all the time. You're the mom. You should do it. As soon as those words come out, I expect Nanai to smack me, but she stares back with a look of surprise. It's this look more than anything that makes me feel like I'm shrinking, like I can disappear right there and then if Nanai wants me to. I don't expect it when she grabs my arm and gives me a quick, angry jerk. What's the matter with you? Frankie and Nita stand there in complete six-year-old fear. Their eyes are wide and they are speechless. All I know is I was mad and I wanted Nanai to know just how much. Frankie lets out a whimper, confused and scared by what just happened. Nanai turns to him. It's okay, sweetie, she says, giving him a reassuring hug. She eyes me again and I look away, wishing I was at the museum already. It makes the kids race me down Santa Fe Avenue. Their little legs move as fast as they can keep up. I try my best not to think of Nana. Part of me feels good for saying what I've been wanting to for a long time. It's a tiny part, but enough for now. After dropping off my brother and sister, I make it just in time for the head count in the parking lot. Alma, my best friend, June calls from the line. I steal a place next to her and ignore the nasty glances from Marta and Becca. The bus ride is bumpy and loud like always. 5 minutes into it and I'm already car sick. June is probably the most excited. Her dad was an artist and made a lot of money back in Manila. Here in the States, he works as a cashier at Vaughn's. He gives us the double coupon discount every time. June keeps talking about the different works we're going to see. Her family goes to museums when they can. According to June, their last trip to LAFMA, that's what she calls it, was a year ago. You don't understand, it's a good time to go. Modigliani's there. What's a Modiglio? I try not to let her see me roll my eyes. He's a famous Italian painter. Wait, no, he's from France, I think. Oh, I forget, she waves her hand in the air and leans back in her seat. Whatever, I say, looking out the window to see the endless gray concrete that makes the 110 freeway. The bus ride takes forever. The highway is packed with cars. Everyone is going to work. Eric Padilla and Dexter Bustamante sit behind us, start kicking the back of our seat out of boredom. Knock it off, I yell without turning around. What's the matter, Alma? You on your period? Dexter teases while Eric laughs. Shut up. June turns to them. How do you even know what a period is, she asks. My mom's a nurse, Dexter says, kicking our seat again. How come she tells you about girly things? Guess she doesn't think you need to know about guy stuff since you act like a sissy. Dexter's smile disappears and June promptly turns around with a satisfied grin. Things quiet down after an hour. Some students fall asleep. We're in L.A., city now. I can tell because there are tall buildings in the distance and the sky is covered with a light brown haze. I can't help but think of this morning and how I ran out on Nanai. Everything was left a mess, dirty dishes on the table and Frankie's pea-stained pants still on the floor, stinking up the apartment. Life in the States has been smaller and grungier compared to what we used to have. In Cebu, we had a swimming pool in the backyard and a jet stream bathtub that could fit three people. Nana used to let me bathe in it on weekends. They have no idea about the... Nana used to let me bathe in it on weekends. Frankie and Nita never did because they were too small. They have no idea about the Philippines, but I remember it all. I remember the smell of the rain, the soft, sucky feel of the mud as you walk on it. I remember eating ripe bananas and mangoes that Amalia would bring every morning with fresh pandesal. I miss the sweet